Yeah. Will you approach me? The lady says, no, thank you. She says, madam, please don't disconnect your telephone. I'm sure you have children who go to school and you send them in the bus. Now, if you employ me, I will take your children to school, leave them, and then after the school, I'll bring them and I'll give you further 5% discount. I'm sure now you will employ me. The lady says, oh, thank you. So, madam, please don't disconnect your telephone. I'm sure you have a garden outside your house. And if you employ me, I will move the garden to vernier caliper accuracy. So the people around will say, agar garden is so beautiful, to andar rehne wala kitna wonderful. Uske liye further 5% discount. Madam said, no, thank you. So, madam, I'm sure you get guests at home. I was working with a chef some time back. I am trained in preparing English, Continental, Punjabi, South Indian, etc. So when guests come at home, I will prepare all the food that you want and I will clean the kitchen so that nobody will come to know ki 30 logon ka khana bhi ho gaya. Another 10% discount. Just, I'm sure you will employ me now. She said, no, Baba. No, thank you. She said, madam, please don't disconnect the phone. I was working with a professor, you know, mad guy. He compulsory made me study history, geography, social studies. I'm trained. You must be employing a tuition teacher at your house. But if you employ me, I will do all the homework of the children. So you don't have to employ the tuition teacher. Another 10% discount. The madam gets irritated. He says, no, Baba, I told you, I have a lot of work. You disconnect the phone. So, madam, exactly. Why you have a lot of work? Because your present bandha is not doing good work. So all the pending work you have to do, if you employ me, there will be no work pending and you can do whatever creative work you want. She says, no, Baba, I told you no. Then thank you, madam, and discourage them. The shopkeeper is watching. तू मेरे पास आ जा। मैं तेरे को नौकरी इसलिए नहीं दे रहा हूँ कि तूने ये बात किया। मैं सच्चे दिल से नौकरी दे रहा हूँ कि because I need you। तू मेरे पास आ जा। तेरा रोटी, कपड़ा, मकान सब का व्यवस्था करूँगा। इधर घर भी दे दूँगा। तेरे को स्कूल में भी भेजूँगा। Because I am impressed with whatever you did। And इतना ही नहीं, आगे जाके तेरे को अगर खुद का दुकान खोलने का तो मैं तेरे को 25% कैपिटल भी दे दूंगा। Etc. etc. And then I want you to develop, and I am doing all this only to favor you. No, only to favor me, because I think I need you more than you need me. So, iske liye, please join me. This young boy says, thank you, uncle, thank you. I am delighted. I don't want a job. So talking to that lady, giving discount after discount after discount, and now you think don't want job. Well, uncle, I'm actually working for the same lady. And I gave her so many offers, and yet she's not willing to change. That means I am satisfied that she's satisfied. That I'm doing a good job. That is the meaning of the service. That is what you have to understand. The meaning of the service, and my parting slide with you. It is important to understand that success is a process while failure is a mechanism. Failure jadoo bhari kudiya hai, and success is a process. Those who see the seeds of failure in success are humble, and those who see the seeds of success in failure are hopeful. People are successful, but they are so humble, they have kaash mein fail hota so, so let me be humble, let success not go to my head. And those who are failures, they say, yaar, main fail kyun hua? Shayad yeh maine galti kiya. Agli baar ye galti nahi karunga. So hopefully, I'll probably become successful. And therefore, friends, let's all join together, humbly and hopefully, in building our India into a great nation that we are. And how do we do that? Benchmark for the best. And be a benchmark for the rest. That's the message that I want to write. Benchmark for the best. And benchmark for the rest. Friends, जाते जाते मैं सिर्फ इतना ही कहूंगा, मरने को नहीं जीने के लिए भी विश चाहिए, मरने को नहीं जीने के लिए भी विश चाहिए, मुस्कुराने के लिए अशकों का बारिश चाहिए, मोहब्बत मोहब्बत में क्या चाहिए है ना मुझको पता, लेकिन इस देश को नागपुर से एक्सपोर्ट जरूर जाए।
थोड़ा सा ब्रेक कुछ सेकेंड का, आफ्टर दैट वंस अगेन वी हैव अमंग विद अस मिस्टर अभिषेक सर। आई वेलकम यू सर, प्लीज वेलकम सर विद फ्लोरल बुके एट द हैंड्स ऑफ अनुप मेहता सर। थैंक यू। अवर नेक्स्ट स्पीकर is also coming up with very and various multifaceted areas, who has already worked with Wipro and mainly concentrating in the area of business development and client acquisition as director with Global Asia Group of Industries, which is mainly involved in the area of exports, licensing, customs, trade, etc. By not taking much time of yours, I would like to call upon sir to share his experience with you.
Very good evening to all of you. I'm sure after this session from Kirtan sir, it's very difficult. I've got very large shoes to fill. There's nothing more left that I can share with you. But nevertheless, I'll try my level best to share whatever little experience I've gathered over the past few years. So I've been working for the past 10 years in my business of custom broking and freight forwarding. I'm an industrial engineer and I've done my MBA from Narasimhanji. I've also done my LLB from Nagpur University. Being an industrial engineer requires you to constantly think about optimization. So even in logistics, you are constantly thinking of how to optimize. You know, I pushed this a bit too far. At home, I told my wife, you know, you probably take five steps here and you do too many rounds between the kitchen and the table. Why don't you get few plates together? Why don't you cook simultaneously on two burners, so on and so forth? And I was sharing this entire piece of data with one of my professors from Ramdev Baba. I told him that I have told my wife that this was she needs to do. She's been doing too many rounds of the kitchen. He asked me, so did it work? I said, of course it did. She used to make the breakfast in 30 minutes. Now I make it in 20. So, you know, you don't have to put optimization too far. Kirtan sir, the problem sometimes with logisticians like us is that the customer or the cargo comes to us when the cargo was supposed to be delivered yesterday. So the cargo arrives today. And it was to be delivered yesterday to the destination, so that is where I think the problem starts, and I think we are always planning forward. So, I am the local boy. The main idea of having me here was to give you a snapshot of the logistic industry in and around Nagpur. What does Mihan hold for us? How does GST look for future in Nagpur? What are the kind of infrastructure that we need in Nagpur to capitalize on the opportunities that Nagpur is going to be benefited from? A lot of people say Nagpur is the central location. It has an advantage, but it also has a disadvantage. You are far from nowhere, but you are also near to nowhere. So one of the problem is, and you are not a consumption center, neither are we a production center. So Bombay, why it has flourished, why Pune has flourished is because Nagpur is in the center of the country. It's very good for logistics, but the problem is it's at this juncture only good for logistics. There's a lot of effort that has been put in politically and by the entrepreneurs, you know, in Nagpur, but as far as the production center, we still count Western Maharashtra as the production center as far as Maharashtra is concerned. And the same is true for consumption also. So it is only logical that a lot of facilities will come in that area, which is the production and the consumption center. So that's the first change we need to do, is to ensure that Nagpur or the Central India region becomes the production center, and that is when we will benefit from all the infrastructure which grows. I'll quickly just take a snapshot of what does export really mean.
Can anyone please help me with the definition of what export is?
Any goods which go out of the territory of India is called export.
Perfect. Is that all? Suppose I take material, any cargo, I go 12 nautical miles beyond the land border of the country, throw it into the ocean, would that qualify as export?
This.
Why wouldn't it qualify as export?
Because it didn't reach the customer.
So if I'm producing something, I have a mission and a vision towards it. Definitely I want to make profits, but I want to reach out to have the value of my product.
Right.
I do not want to waste it.
Absolutely.
It would not be a step delivery. Like if you throw the cargo 12 miles away in sea or in ocean, so it would not reach to its own destination.
I'm just giving you a case study. I was told taking the material out of the country is export. I asked whether this is export.
Yeah, naturally if I'm producing something, if my domestic supply, if it suffices and goes beyond, because if my own country, like if I'm producing something and if my country needs some thing which I'm producing, definitely for them. But if I'm producing more and I can, you know, it can suffice to more people outside,
but what exactly would be export? Selling goods from under, I'm saying specific terms from India, we are trying to export goods. What would entail as export? If I throw the goods in the ocean, is it export because it's one out of the country? Okay, that's brilliant. You completed the loop. One is, it should go out of the country. It should go beyond 12 nautical miles of the country's borders. And the money should be received in freely convertible currency. So there are only 11 convertible currencies, freely convertible currencies like dollars, euros, Singapore dollars, Australian dollars, Canadian dollars, so on and so forth. Dirham is incidentally not a freely convertible currency, but you can still take commissions and get your proceeds in Dirham. Now, let's take one more example. Suppose I take this material, throw it into the ocean, I get money from America for throwing it into the ocean. Is that export?
No.
Yes, it is. So if you throw the money, if you get the money, freely convertible currency, the country wants to export more because they get foreign exchange currency, and that is they have a bill of exchange, and the net import and exports you would want to increase and have a bigger foreign exchange reserve. And that's why they want to promote export. Corollary of this, what is import? Material should come within the country. And? Material should come within the country?
Yeah. But then we give out dollar.
Okay. Indian customs says we don't care whether you give the dollar or not. If the material is coming within the country, you pay the duty and it's yours. So for export, we need to send the material out of the country and get money in freely convertible currency. When does the ownership change of the export cargo? So I'll give you an example. You've exported the cargo. You've not read the bill of lading, what's written behind it. Okay? It goes boards the vessel, and the vessel sails. You've insured the cargo. Who gets the insurance? I'm saying you manufacture the cargo. You put it onto the vessel. The vessel is high seas, it sinks, you lose the cargo, you insure the material. Who gets the money of the insurance?
You will get the money.
Who will get
it? Depends on the info terms, that the delivery terms that it is going on. FOB.
Let's say FOB, who gets the money?
We get the money. Money will, it sinks in the sea, then the buyer will get the money.
Consignee will get the money.
Yes.
What if it's CIF, who gets the money?
Then we will get the money. Exporter.
Okay. Let's assume another case. Now that we'll hold this on, that the vessel has gone down and you have insured the cargo, the terms are CIF. The moment I load it onto the vessel. I got the PL. I ran to the bank. I discounted my LC. I got the money for the cargo. Now the cargo has gone down. Now I get the money for the insurance. So I would pray that every time I load the cargo, the vessel sinks. Because I get twice the amount of money. Isn't that true?
No.
With that logic, in CIF, if the vessel sinks, if the shipper would get the money, in that case, I have the BL in my hand from which I have already taken the money from the bank, and the vessel sinks, I get the money from the insurance also. Are you getting the impediment?
Yes.
Do you get the problem? So insurance is always in the favor of the consignee. It's never in favor of the shipper. And incidentally, the ownership of the cargo transfers the moment it crosses the rails of the ship. Which means the moment, irrespective of your Incoterms, your ownership has been transferred to the consignee the moment it is on board the vessel. The moment you put the container on the vessel, it is now the consignee's cargo. If anything happens to the cargo, the benefit or the insurance of that will be to the consignee, because you already discharged. Now, why would you say that if CIF is my Incoterm, how does the ownership transfer to the consignee the moment I cross the rail of the ship? Because there is a difference between what are you responsible for, what you pay for, and where does the ownership transfer. You are only responsible to have or book the freight of the cargo to the destination port, but not the owner while the vessel is high seas. So these are small little points that are there in exports that you generally need to cover. The other thing which I wanted to develop on is that as far as the warehousing, a lot of people are anticipating that warehousing would get a fillip the moment GST comes in and Nagpur can become a distribution hub. All of us are vying for that. Future Group, which is the Big Bazaar Group, has already got their mother warehouse in Nagpur. They are doing a lot of imports into Nagpur and distributing goods throughout the country. A few seminars that I have attended, they are anticipating that because the consumption hub is Bombay, they would have one warehouse in Bombay which will take care of Western Maharashtra, because it's most of, more or less 50% of the country's intake. Rest they would want to move to Nagpur. Unfortunately, the infrastructure is still not there. Even if GST comes, even if Mihan comes, the infrastructure is still not there. Like sir said, the value addition and services are still not there. In Europe, there are companies that take cargo. The moment you manufacture the cargo, they would take it to the warehouse, do barcoding. Their systems are aligned with the system of the manufacturer. They would tell them, this is what your inventory is. They would get a mandate from them that this is how you need to distribute your cargo, and they can do that. But as of now, we do not have expertise to provide such services, which would be required by companies who would look at Nagpur as their center warehouse. The next problem is people will come from other cities like Bombay, and then eventually we will be left high and dry only thinking about the fact that there have been people who come from outside and we still are doing measly jobs, very low level jobs, or low level outsourcing would happen. So I think the next challenge for us is training ourselves and making ourselves equipped to meet the requirements of the future. That is where more investment would be required. Infrastructure will keep flowing in as and when time passes by, but as of now, training, quality of services, anticipation of what is the requirement of the industry, I think that will be the hallmark. If that is what is achieved, Nagpur will grow. Otherwise, we will have a brain pool coming to Nagpur and we will still be doing measly jobs and providing supporting functions. Thank you very much for your patient listening. In case there are any queries, please do let me know. Yes, sir.
Can you just throw some light on what exactly is going to happen? Because the things that you just mentioned are correct, right? That we'll be doing the main jobs only and nothing else. But what exactly we look forward and what exactly we do? Can you throw some light more on that particular thing?
A lot of warehousing might happen, but it has to be very directed warehousing. So a lot of people come to us asking, should we build warehouses in Nagpur? I say no. first go to the company and figure out that which company is willing to use your warehouse and what are their specifications. Suppose Upin comes in, your pharmaceutical warehouse looks very different than what a general cargo warehouse is. And a FMCG warehouse is very different, and similarly a clothes or yarn warehouse is very different. So if you have the product or something in mind, only then building a warehouse makes sense. Making a general warehouse might not be the right thing because we thought that we would get a fillip, but warehousing costs to be, I mean, commercially accurate, you are still scraping at 6 to 8 rupees per square feet. Whereas even in a place like Bhiwandi where you can't even park your vehicle, you are still paying about 15 to 20 rupees a square feet. So people are willing to take that as a service and still not coming to Nagpur, so there is a reason for that. So there has to be more pinpointed approach on what kind of warehousing are we looking at, what are the companies that we are looking at, and anticipate what the requirements are. See, internationally, Mihan was considered to be a multimodal hub wherein the flights would come in and we would become the distribution center for Southeast Asia. But we took some more time than what we should have, and unfortunately, that epicenter has moved to Hyderabad. Now, we have to ensure that the moment GST comes, how much difference that does a Raipur make, which is 250 kilometers from here, or how much difference does a 400 kilometer distance Indore make, which is a bigger consumption center than us. So, in wake of that, we need to be better prepared, equipped to provide the right kind of services, as Sir pointed out, that services that Delta is red is what will create the differential. Because we really think that warehouses can't be built in Raipur, or probably they can't be built in Hyderabad, like we've already lost the air hub to Hyderabad. Why wouldn't we lose the road hub to any other neighboring town? So that is where a lot of training and service related perspectives need to come in to make Nagpur the logistics hub.
And any perspective regarding, since warehousing, you are saying this will be difficult and challenging factor, or pinpoint warehousing is supposed to be coming here in Nagpur. But any specifics regarding, companies have to have a warehouse here in Nagpur, right? But it might even happen that people from other states are coming and dumping goods over here, so people from Nagpur, they will not be having businesses also, right? Because directly after GST, they will be coming and dumping goods over here. Or from Indore, or from Jabalpur, or Raipur, or the neighboring state, as you said, they will be coming and dumping goods over here, and they might be used this as a logistics hub only to send goods to any part of the country. So if warehousing is also not coming, then what is the solution to people coming from outside and dumping goods at Nagpur?
Warehousing will definitely come, because hub and spoke model is the best distribution model that has been seen by any company. So there always has to be a hub, and then you have these spokes which do the distribution. I don't know if you remember, sir, there was Deccan 360, started by Captain Gopinath, and they had kept Nagpur as their hub. I was involved with that project, and we were their franchisees in Nagpur. Incidentally, it was doing fantastic. So they ensured that they had flights from Ahmedabad, Bombay, Nagpur. They had flights from Patna and one more place to Nagpur. Then they had Calcutta, Nagpur, Bangalore, Chennai, Nagpur, and Cochin, Nagpur. And all these flights used to come in the night, redistribute their entire cargo, and they used to take off in the morning. And they had provided a fantastic connection between all these tier 1 and tier 2 cities. Unfortunately, they failed because of few strategic reasons, but having said that, that is when my personal experience has been that the hub and spoke model with Nagpur as the epicenter will definitely work. There is no problem with that. But yet there are a few things in GST that we need to still take care of, like what happens to stock transfers. So that's one of the reasons based on which a lot of warehousing is anticipated into Nagpur, whether stock transfer will be at the same price, at the same taxation. Do we have to pay in advance in case of stock transfer takes place, or do we pay at the time when the stock is distributed from the epicenter? So suppose there is someone who is manufacturing in let's say Jamshedpur. If he sends his cargo for national distribution to Nagpur and maintains his mother warehouse at Nagpur, does he have to pay GST the moment it comes to Nagpur, or does he pay GST when he starts distributing from Nagpur? So that will be another point to check, because then we are talking of 28%, sometimes 18% of cash flows being trapped only in taxation. So there are still few more steps that we need to cross before we can say that this is what the future holds for us. There's no doubt about the fact that logistically it's a no-brainer that Nagpur has to prosper. Rail connectivity is fantastic. Indore fails there. Raipur fails there. So Nagpur has to prosper because we have fantastic rail connectivity. No other city in the country is providing this kind of rail connectivity. So you will be fractured for rail connectivity from any other city that you think of close by. But maybe, you know, we need to up our strengths further to capitalize on this opportunity that might come in the maybe coming 3 years.
Last, I would like to know that about Mihan. In Mihan, you said that we have already lost our air advantage to Hyderabad, right? So Mihan is like not picking up as we anticipated. So why aren't the politicians, you know, really claiming that okay, Mihan is not going to work out at this moment? Why we are still delaying, and Mihan is not picking up the last 10 years? Any strategic point that I'm not aware of that you might be aware of?
See, Mihan was conceptualized because you would be surprised to know that there are 300 international flights that cross the Nagpur airspace. So every day there are 300 international flights that are crossing Nagpur airspace. So that was the logic that if this is going to be the intersection point, then this makes a lot of sense. But you know, with that kind of distance, 300, 400 kilometers here or there doesn't make sense, and that's why we lost the bus, because we were late. I would abstain from commenting on what politicians can do, what they cannot. I think any place is as good as the people who stay there. So we as entrepreneurs should bear the mantle of ensuring that this place is worthy of the ride. So that is the only reason why I urge that apart from infrastructure that we are looking at, so only making a warehouse, buying plots and having a godown in place might not be the be all and end all. Maybe we have to have that Z factor there. Maybe we have to add that delta Y, which will ensure that it comes to Nagpur. Because there are other people who are competing in the same frame, they don't have much to lose. So from that perspective, I think inventory management, better distribution, better logistics, more visibility, because it's not always that there's only movement of cargo, there's movement of information as well. So as Sir pointed out, that services are an important part. Why is a sister sending Rakhi by DHL and not by some XYZ courier? Both say that we are going to deliver in 5 days to America. Both are as reliable. The XYZ is cheaper. Still she sends it by DHL because she says, when it's Raksha Bandhan, I want to know whether my Rakhi has reached or not. And that is where DHL is adding value. DHL might be charging you 3 times. But DHL says, I will tell you when it is in Antwerp. I will tell you when it has reached New York. I will tell you when it's reached Atlanta. I will tell you when it reaches the place. The XYZ says, don't worry. I will deliver before time. But the problem is, those 4 days, even if you deliver before time, I have no visibility of my cargo. And that is where the differential will come in. So I think services will differentiate logistics in the time to come more than infrastructure. That's my hunch, of course. Thank you very much for taking time.
Moving ahead to have concluding remarks, I would like to call upon Mr. Anup Mittal from WTC Mumbai to elaborate the names of awardees, as certain names were shortlisted for the extraordinary contribution in international trade, and the awards will be distributed at the hands of Sri Kurvula Sir, WTC Mumbai, Sri Atul Pandeji, President, VI Nagpur, and Sri Khelsar Sir, WTC Mumbai. Sri Anup Sir.
Dr. Kumar. Yes. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On the occasion of World Trade Center Mumbai, awarded in Maharashtra, World Trade Center Mumbai is pleased to honor eminent persons who have excelled in the promotion of international trade in the state of Maharashtra. May I honor request Mr. Kurvila to do the honors. First, we would like to present the award of honor to ASA Agrotech Private Limited in the category of MSME Export Achievers in the recognition of the company's excellence in exports of farm products. ASA Agrotech Private Limited has been the largest exporter of sterile negro seeds, which is used as a bird seed to the USA and Canada for the last 10 years. The company's processing plant is situated in Nagpur and is certified by the US Department of Agriculture and the National Plant Protection Organization, India. The company supplies premium quality negro seeds to Walmart, USA, which is one of the largest retail chains in the world. In future, the company is largest bird feed supplies from India. On behalf of the company, may I request Mr. Sheetal to receive the award. Congratulations, Ms. Seetal.
Thank you.
We'd like to present the next award of honor to R&Y Logistics Private Limited in the category of Global Logistics Award in the recognition of company's excellence in providing logistics services to exporters. Established in 1996, R&Y Logistics Private Limited started its service at ICD Nagpur and now providing services in Raipur, Mumbai, Aurangabad, Vishakhapatnam, and Krishnapatnam. The company handles around 50,000 containers per annum and serves around 200 exporters and importers. On behalf of the organization, Mr. Rao, Congratulations, Mr. Rao. The next award of honor is presented to Sudeshis Private Limited in the category of Global Business Head in recognition of company's excellence in the export of food products. Let me brief you about Sudeshis Private Limited. It was founded in the name of Ganesh Enterprises by Dr. Subhash Ji Chen in 1979, originally started as a manufacturer and supplier of fine quality spices. The company has, in course of time, diversified into other products such as papad, ale, sauce, ketchup, and pickles. The company has acquired all relevant quality certificates such as AGMAR, ISO 22000, 2005, and approval from Food Safety and Standard Authority of India. On behalf of the company, Dr. Subhash will collect the award. Dr. Subhash Bhade will collect the award. Congratulations, Dr. Swas Buddha. The next award of
congratulations, Surichi.
Suruchi. That's my bad. Okay, the next award of honor is presented to Dr. Mr. Sagar Kirtani from Webpet IT Solutions in the category of Small Business Global Trade in recognition of company's excellence in offering digital marketing solutions to foreign clients. Nagpur-based Webpet Private Limited is a startup company founded by four innovative youngsters. In 2014, the company offers web-based solution digital marketing healthcare solution to clients in India and North America.
Commission of the startup.
The next award of honor is presented to Mr. Vishal Chawla from Flying Penguins in the category of Small Business Global Trade in the recognition of company's excellence in providing digital marketing solutions to foreign companies.
Congratulations,
Mr. Chawla.
Thank you. Thank you. Congratulations,
Mr. Chawla. The next award honor is presented to Mr. Abdul Pandey from VIA in the category of Export Facilitation in recognition of association commitment to promote trade and investment.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Mr. VIP.
Thank you.
May I request all the awardees to have a good photo?
Please, all the awardees. Awardees
can stand. Please hold your water. Sir, also hold the
water.
Yes, sir.
Hold
the water.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Ready?
I'm not
you want me to go down?
आगे वाले का फोटो आना चाहिए, पीछे वाले का चिंता मत।
One second.